Welcome to Programming the 1401, Part 5. Today we are going to solve the problem of loading a slightly bigger program and generating a listing of the data of several punch data cards, which contain some personal data like name, personal number, date of birth, the office number and the department ID. And we want to list this data nicely like this. It may help if you have seen the video about running a small program in part 4, Hello World, and the video about word marks in part 3. See the links below. In the last video, we printed Hello World on our printer. There we had the program and the data on the same card, so the program could run directly in the card buffer at address 1. On the card, we had a part with the data to be printed, the yellow part, the part with the program which moved the data to the print buffer and issued the print command, the red area, and for the 1401, we needed a part which added the word marks to the program and the data, the blue part. But once the card was prepared, we could take it, put it in our card reader, check the settings, press the load button, and the card gets loaded into the computer, the program gets started, and we get our Hello World printed. For our new goal, we have several issues compared to the Hello World program. First, the data is on extra cards. Program and data can't share the same card. Second, reading the data cards and printing them nicely would need a longer program, which will not fit onto only one card. Third, reading these data cards will overwrite any data which has previously been in the card buffer, because cards will always be loaded beginning at address 1, and so will also overwrite any program there. So we need a technique to split a program into several cards and to move it into another memory area, so that the card buffer is free for the data to be read. Let's first write the program to list the cards on the printer. We will solve the problem of getting the program into memory later. The card data has a fixed format. In our case, we have a personal number, the name, the date of birth, a number of the office, and the department, like LG for logistics department. The result should be a nicely printed list, like this, with a header and an end line, only the first character of the first name, and a German date format. A flow diagram may look like this. We clear all buffers, then set the necessary word marks, then move the table header to the print buffer and issue the print command, and then clear the print buffer again to get rid of the header. Set the dots for the abbreviated first name and for the German date. Then read the first card. Move the data fields from the card buffer to the intended destination in the print buffer and print that line. We don't need to clear the buffer now, because the next card will overwrite exactly the same locations. We can now try to read the next card and repeat the print process until there are no more cards. We then clear the print buffer of the card data, move the end line to the buffer, and call print a last time. Using a start address of, for example, 501 for the program and 701 for the text data, the machine program could look like this. We have the clear memory and the set wordmark part, the printing of the header, we set the dots, we read a card, we move the card data to the print buffer and print it, read the next card and check if it's the last one, and if so, print the end line. Additionally, there's a fixed data like the header, the end text, and the dot at address 701. Now we only have to get the program loaded to address 501 via some punched cards. What we need is a program to load a program, kind of a bootloader. A program for loading a multi-card program uses a similar technique as our Hello World program, means there's a part which can be executed from the card buffer after the card has been loaded, but in this case doesn't do real data processing, like printing Hello World, but instead has to move the desired program, the payload, into the memory. There are many different ways to write a program which can load the actual program into memory. There are some being recommended by IBM, many have been written by individual programmers, some only add one program instruction per card, others use a compressed format, some are easily manually creatable and readable, others are not. Some are generated manually, others are generated automatically by the related assembler or compiler. I will use a format where the first 39 columns of the card contain the load program and the last 41 columns contain the actual program, the payload. In this case, the cards have at most 50% payload. The rest is needed to circumvent the constraints of the card loading process. This format is a bit cumbersome to create manually, and there are formats which are easier to create or read, but which have an even worse utilization. For example, this format suggested by IBM is very easy to handle, but would use 36 cards for our example. But at that time, cards have been cheap consumables. The demand for punch cards for dynamic data was several orders of magnitude higher than those for program cards, so no one really cared. Here we have the program load card contents. On the right-hand side, you see the original program that we want to run later. On the left-hand side, there's the contents of the first card, which loads the first part of our program. There, the upper part loads our program to the desired memory location. The lower part contains the program to be loaded. The first command, move 079 to 540, loads the first part encircled on the right. Remember that the move command works from higher memory down to lower memory locations, until it finds a word mark. So here we would also need a word mark at location 040 to stop the move, but this detail will be covered later. Nevertheless, we also need the regular word marks for the program instructions in the new location. This is being done here by the following set word mark commands. We have space to set a maximum of 8 word marks. If we don't need all of them, they may be replaced by no operation commands. So now we loaded the first part of the program to address 501 and need to continue with the next part. The 1401 provides a combined load and jump command. First, the load card command 1 reads the next card into the card area and then afterwards executes the jump to 001 command. So now card number 2 has been loaded and again the move command at address 001 get executed, in this case to move the second part of the program to the desired location. Set the required word marks for the next section and then load the third card and so on until the last part of the program has been loaded. What's missing is a constant data, in our case the table header and footer, and the dots for the name and date, which we load with card number 7 and 8. Since that was the last card, we do not load the next card. Instead, the last command is a stop command, which of course stops execution and lights the stop button on the front panel. So we are more or less complete with loading the program, but there's one detail I've left out so far, which has to be prepared in beforehand. First, the loading program itself may use some word marks. For example, we need word marks for the move and read command, and we especially need a word mark at location 40 to stop the move command, moving our program to the destination area. Second, in the area where we put the program, there may be word marks from previous programs. This would disturb the move command, since word marks not only on the source side, but also word marks on the destination side stop the transfer, so we would get incomplete programs and commands with word marks at the wrong position. The solution are two cards, which we process before the actual program load. The first card sets the word marks that we need for the bootloader, and the second card clears the destination memory area, so that the following cards can move the program without any obstacles. So we are now ready to punch the cards. Let's walk over to the punch. And let's start. .008050. So now I've finished punching the cards. Let's eject the cards. Let's take the stack and walk over to the tray. Let's see. So here we have the cards, with the first card setting the word marks for the bootloader, reading the next card, clearing the memory from 799 down, 699 down, 599 down to 500, reading the next card, loading the first part of the program, which we can see here it's the second part beginning at column 40. Next card was the second part of the program, next card, next card, next card. This is the last card with the program. We see the stop here. This is the card with the first part of the fixed character data. And this is the second part of character data. And you see here the dot, which is the stop of the bootloader. So at this point, the loading of the program should have finished. We now should be able to start the bootloader and load the program into the desired area. Let's take the cards, put them into the card reader. Let's set the 1401 to run. Reset the status and press load. The cards have been loaded. The stop lamp is lit. Let's do a storage printout. Address 500 and followers address 600. It was 700, so here we see the program that we wanted to load, and we also see the fixed character data that we later need to add to the list. We don't see any word marks in this area because those are set word mark commands and they don't need a word mark itself. Since the program to print the list is loaded now, we should be able to generate our desired list, the result that we want to have printed on this printer. So let's look for the data cards. I think they are here, yes. The cards with the personal number, the name, birth date, and so on. Let's take these cards. Let's put them into the card reader. Now let's reset the status. And now we have to set the start address to address 501, where we have loaded our program. Let's have a look at our list. And run. And start the program. And you see the cards ran through and we got our list. If we want, we could take our cards. Let's get rid of the listing. Could remove the program cards because the program is already in memory. Take our data cards. Put it in the card reader again. Reset the status. Set the instruction pointer to 501 again. And let's see. Set the mode to run and start. And you see we get the same listing a second time because of course we use the same data cards. So we performed three steps. First we've put the bootloader into the card reader, then loaded the bootloader to get our program into area 500. Then we've put our data cards into the card reader and then we've manually started the program at address 501 to get the printout. In a real-world application, it would be nice to have only one step. And we will now have a look how to achieve this. At the end of our bootloader, we had a stop command. The bootloader simply stopped, the program was loaded at 501, but nothing more happened. To avoid a manual start at address 501 after the bootloader has finished, we could simply add a branch command at the last card, which jumps to location 501. So the steps would be the bootloader loads, the bootloader moves the program to address 501 and then automatically starts this program. So we could take away this card, put it here, take this card I've already prepared. The only difference is the branch to 501. And what we now also could do, we could take our data cards and put them right behind our program. So our bootloader would load the program. The program would be started at address 501. And directly behind the bootloader, there are the data cards in the card reader. So now it should be possible to take all these cards, the bootloader and the data cards, put them into the card reader, set the machine into the RAID status. Let's have a look. Empty paper. Let's press load. Bootloader, data cards, and we get our listing. So the operator had only to perform one step, put the stack into the card reader, press load, and we got our listing.